On today's show, a very special guest demonstrates a dog gaming console.
We also have a human being, don't worry, and his name is Dan Casey. He's from The Nerdist, and he's going to tell us some of his favorites from the CES show floor.
And he might also demonstrate a dog game console. It's Tomorrow Daily. Greetings, citizens of the internet. Welcome to Tomorrow Daily, the best geek talk show in the known universe. I'm Ashley Skeva.
And I'm Jeff Cannata, and we have a guest joining us right at the top here.
Yes. Will you please tell everybody what you're with Clever Pet, and please tell everybody who you are and what you do there.
This is Dan Knudsen.
I'm one of the co-founders of Clever Pet. I'm also the CTO, CSO.
Clever Pet. Yes. Now tell us what the goal of Clever Pet is.
The goal of Clever Pet is to give America's dogs who spend a lot of time home alone when their people go off to work something meaningful and engaging to do all day long.
All right, so you have done something very special for us here at CNET Stage. We actually have a very special guest, Princess Fiona.
That's right.
Will be joining us. So if we could bring Princess
Fiona out.
That's
not just my stage name.
That is not just Jeff's stage name and the name he gives to the hotels when he stays at them. This is Princess Fiona.
Princess Fiona is adorable.
Hi, Princess Fiona. You're so cute.
Look how unhappy she is to be left home alone.
She's just like, please, no, don't leave me home alone.
She wants something fun and engaging to do.
So we also have Clever Pet. We have the console right down here.
Yeah.
And if you could walk us through how exactly it works, that would be great.
Yeah, so what the console does is it presents simple games to dogs using lights and sounds. It's got three light-up touch pads at the front, and it's got a speaker in the back. So you can present simple puzzles, and when dogs solve the puzzles by pressing the right button at the right time, they get a bit of their food for the day. And it's connected to Wi-Fi, so you can keep track of how they're doing all day long, and we can adjust difficulty in real time.
I know
you can adjust the difficulty? Like, oh,
that's
too
right.
much food.
Yeah, that's
too
right.
Much food.
So I've been training animals for the last 13 years with computers and machines. I have a PhD in neuroscience, and we're taking the science of animal behavior and bringing it into the home.
Excellent. Okay, well, let's can we test it out?
Sure.
This seems like a really smart dog. I don't know if this could work on a dog like
this is amazing.
My dogs.
Okay, so...
So she's on a very simple game. It starts out very easy.
Yeah.
And oop, my microphone just fell off here. It starts out very easy, and all she has to do is press one of the lit up buttons.
Okay.
Any of them will work.
Any of them will work at
Come
first.
Come on, Princess, you can
oh,
do
she
it.
She did it.
She did
it
already.
She touched one of the buttons, and it opened up.
No, what you'll see
food.
Over time is as she gets a few right, the game will get a little bit harder. Then there'll only be two lit up, and she's got to press the one that's lit up.
Her nose.
All right, is there a boss
Great
battle
work,
at some
Princess
point?
Princess, yeah, do we
We're
have
working
boss
on that.
Raids? Are there dog raids? Because I have a few dogs in my house. Could they team up and take on for a better treat?
Like, yeah, see, so you see now only two of them are lit up. She pressed the middle
you
one.
You got to do a flashing one.
Yeah.
Come on,
no,
Princess.
Pick another one, Princess Fiona.
She's like, where's that food at?
There you go.
She got lucky.
That's great. That's so great.
So is there a danger of my dog becoming too clever?
I don't know.
I mean,
I
don't want a dog to be smarter than me, especially at video games. I have enough problem with the kids on League of Legends making fun of me.
Maybe you need a wing pup.
Well, thank you, Princess Fiona. We'll let you go back to the green room and relax, and we'll bring the Clever Pet right up here onto the desk so we can take a look at it.
Yay,
thank you, everybody.
Princess
give a hand
Fiona.
For Princess Fiona.
Someday she will be queen.
Someday she will be queen. Also, cutest CES attendee. I think I can reasonably give out that award. Jeff, I think I would like you to try this.
Okay.
But I think we need to give you a dog mask.
All right. Well, that seems only fair.
All right. You have a theater. You're majored in theater. So I need you to...
So I'll have some mask work?
I need you to...
This
you
is my proudest moment, by the way.
I need you to channel a dog for me, okay?
My
pretend
proudest
you're a dog.
Moment.
Pretend you're your dog.
Mom and Dad, this is what I do for a living.
Dogs don't talk. Are you ready?
Yeah.
All right. Okay, so it's going to flash. Okay, so these flash.
Yeah.
That's right.
As
so
it gets harder, less flash.
That's right.
And then you get a treat.
There you go, and I got to eat it.
I'm not going to eat
you
that.
You should eat that. Yeah,
I'm not
eat don't
that.
Eat that.
That is, I felt what it was like to be a dog.
For just a second.
To be your dog, in fact. This is cool.
This started as a crowdfund, right?
Yeah, that's right. We did a Kickstarter, yeah. So we had 1,000 backers, just under 1,000 backers sign up to get one of these. And we've opened pre-orders just during CES, so you can get them through tomorrow at our website.
Oh, awesome.
So is the idea that we're going to be sitting at work with a little webcam watching the dog play video games?
Yeah, some people want to play like that. So,
yeah.
So we have a mobile app, so you can check in and see how your dog is doing. We'll update that with how much they've eaten, when they level up.
They're leveling up?
Yeah. Yeah.
Dog
the dogs,
RPGs.
The dogs will rule us all.
Dog RPG. Soon my dog will be able to play Fallout for me. And then just let me know how it went.
I want my dog to be a cleric.
Yes.
Any other levels of complexity? It's pushing light in.
Yeah, so it starts really simple like this to get them to understand how to use a game. You know, we know how to use keyboards and pens and pencils, but dogs don't understand what a button is. So the first thing we have to do is teach them that. From there, we can do things like pattern games. So my dog, Artie, plays pattern games. He can press blue, yellow, white in a row.
My dog is a fool and will never figure that out.
I bet they would.
We
I bet
refer
your dog
to
would figure
them
it out.
As idiots. Oh. So they're, that's a loving
that's not very
nickname.
Nice.
We call them, well, they're Italian greyhounds, so we call them Igiots. I'm sorry, everybody. It's really lame.
But the levels of offensive there.
They are not bright. They are not bright animals. And so I worry about buying this and having them just stare at it and bark.
I bet that they're more clever than you think. If they like food, this thing starts out very simply just by giving them food for free.
If my dogs are, in fact, too dumb to use this, does Clever Pet offer refunds?
Yes, okay, absolutely. Good. Don't worry.
Double checking.
First,
my dog just fell over.
So I'm sorry,
so hungry because I couldn't figure out the video game console.
It died of starvation.
But
just
it won't happen.
So
we haven't found a dog yet, and we've been looking. Right. Yeah.
So have you seen measurable increases in dog intelligence?
Cognitive ability.
Yeah. So I'm a scientist, so I don't like to claim things before I have enough evidence to prove that. So I'm hoping we'll be able to find that and say definitively. But we have seen definite behavioral changes in dogs. What happens is dogs get left home alone, and in the best case, they just sleep all day, not doing anything, and they have all this pent-up energy, right? In the worst case, they'll turn the energy onto the couch or...
Worst case is they do what my dog does, my baby
everywhere.
Jenkins. Who dug a hole in our mattress last night?
Yeah, exactly.
That was the thing.
Exactly. So they have all this energy and they want to use it. They evolved alongside us to have jobs. So we want to put them back to work and make sure they can use that mental energy in an engaging and meaningful way to them.
Awesome. So pre-orders are open now. My next question is, what's the next evolution of this? Is it self-programmable where I can program my voice in here to say, who's a good boy?
Yeah. Yeah,
and then
that
one of these
available.
Say, I am, and then he just hits that one only?
Sure, we could do that.
All right, that would be great. I think that would be my favorite. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for this. We are going to take a very quick break, and then we'll be right back with Nerdist Dan Casey to discuss some of the weirder tech at CES 2016. So stick around. Don't click away. It's Tomorrow Daily. Everybody, we have a great guest with us. We do. We have a great guest, Dan Casey,
who's looking very dapper.
Yeah.
From the Nerdist. Dan, you've been here at CES all week as well.
I've been in the thick of it.
Yeah.
Every hall. At
How
least
thick
once.
Is it?
It's pretty thick out there, I have to say.
Yeah.
I don't know the scientific word for it, but I've never seen this many people centered in one place. I thought like Comic-Con was a lot, but this is sprawling.
I think the estimate was 170,000 people through the doors at any given.
That explains the thickness.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So you've seen some cool stuff. You've seen some weird stuff.
I have.
What stuff would you like to talk about?
I'd like to talk, first of all, this is definitely the coolest thing I've seen so far. It is a 3D printed jetpack. Airwolf and Jetpack Aviation have made a 3D printed jetpack. Previously, this cost about $12,000 to make. Earlier this year, the B-roll you're seeing right now is they flew it around the Statue of Liberty.
Yeah,
this
amazing.
Is for people that think that manufactured jetpacks are too safe.
This is
3D print it yourself.
This is an actual jet turbine.
It actually runs jet turbines, not
turbine
like
power.
Water like you've seen in some other places. And this is really cool because with the 3D printing, it only cost about $400 to manufacture.
Wow.
Which is affordable for me and you.
Yeah, that's less than the Oculus I just bought this week.
I want to predict that next year we might be able to buy a jetpack or a HoloLens for about the same price. These are my squad goals of Tomorrow Daily that we can all just get on jetpacks.
I've seen a lot of 3D printed stuff here at the show, and most of it is snapped together plastic. Mm-hmm. So that's what I'm imagining this jetpack is.
Yeah,
just some guy like Legos. Snapping it together.
Pretty much, it's 8 separate fabricated pieces that they then snap together,
and then you strap to your back
and
fly
fuel
over
inside.
The sea.
Exactly. Yeah, they've only flown over the sea so far. They were very specific about that piece of info.
That seems like a great safety choice.
Yeah.
I'm going to fly over something that will not actually liquefy me if I land.
Yeah, you don't want to be a sidewalk Jackson Pollock. You want to ramp up to that.
Definitely don't want to do that. So I saw, and I've been checking out the Ehong 184. I went and looked at that last night.
Yeah.
It is a one-seater autonomous drone.
Yeah, we talked about this a little yesterday. Mm-hmm. This is nuts. I think a one-seater drone is called a personal helicopter, is it not?
I would imagine it's kind of a personal helicopter.
But a helicopter implies that you have some control over what's going on. This is a robot flying you around.
Yeah, this is a robot so the idea is, if you haven't seen it, it's right here in South Hall. You guys should go check it out. It's by Oculus. You get in, there's a tablet inside the cockpit. You tap where you want to go, and this thing takes off vertically, takes you where you want to go, short range. You get like 23 minutes of battery life, and then it lands, and then you're good. Their goal is, you don't need a pilot's license. No pilot's license required. You just get in, tap where you want to go.
Goodness.
Yeah.
Finally. Something so I can fly that I don't need a silly license for. Yeah.
I don't want to be trained.
As long as it's 23 minutes away, I am golden.
I am good. But 23 minutes as the crow flies, as the drone flies. So you can get kind of far in LA. I feel like you get pretty far in LA.
I don't.
But it's really neat. And they said they didn't want to make it a billionaire's toy, so they're trying to make this.
A millionaire's toy?
Well, so that was my joke. I was like, oh, a millionaire's toy then, but $200,000. That was like the goal. So a couple of Teslas.
For a personal drone, that's not that bad.
It's all electric. Yeah, exactly. It's all electric. They said that they feel it's safe. They just need to get all of the regulations, obviously.
Yeah. Then.
And they want to have enough people own them to where they can have regional command centers where somebody watches, almost like air traffic control.
Talk to me when I can snap it together.
It seems like a 3D printed.
I saw something cool today.
Oh, let's talk about this.
This is the Glyph. This is a pair of earphones that you listen to your music. You're chilling with your music. Got good sound quality. And then let's say you want to watch some video or something.
Like I often do.
Yeah, but I don't want to use my stupid phone screen. No. Flip it down.
And
boom.
Jordy LaForge it.
Jordy LaForge it.
Oh, my God.
It's got eyepieces here, and not screens. Sure. You're not looking at screens.
Yeah. Here's the inside. It's
actually using thousands of tiny mirrors to project the image
right
to your eyeballs.
Really?
So
projects it in your eyes.
So the result is a much higher looking resolution because you're not actually looking at pixels. There's no screen door effect. There's none of that.
Put this on.
Look how rad she looks.
Yeah,
seamlessly integrated with your outfit.
Or
I feel very futuristic. If
I saw somebody doing that, I might think that they had a problem with their earphones. But
excuse me, I think you're wearing those incorrectly, sir.
Yeah. Did you fall asleep, sir?
Yeah, they just flop forward.
But I tried it, and the visual quality, it does 3D. It does head tracking too. So
is it like stereoscopic 3D, or is it?
I don't know.
Maybe.
it looks good. You can watch 3D movies.
I think we have Bob on here.
Yes,
stereoscopic 3D.
Yes.
Yes. All right.
I was watching part of Avengers in 3D on it.
Ooh.
And then you can also do head tracking, so you can see 3D stuff. It'll
Very
serve
nice.
Right from your cell phone or from a computer.
So you can just pull up one of those 360 videos, 360 stuff, and then check things out. That's awesome. Our producer just said not porn. We gotta skip that.
Oh, of course. Why would we
ever? There's other companies doing that, guys.
No. I only want things with VR 3D story.
Yeah. We are very important about story here on Tomorrow Daily. We also, Jeff was brave enough to get into the Intel Sleep Pod.
I got in the Sleep Pod.
What happened inside its Stygian depths?
Well, I went to the year 2247, and then
God.
I came back.
Came back in time.
No, this is an egg-like device. There's me getting into it. There is an egg-like device where you sit in it, and then they close you off, and you wear the headphones, and they measure your heart rate. It dropped my heart rate by like 10 to 15. I was 86 when I got in, 71 when I got out.
Really?
Yeah.
It's comforting, but I just...
But did you have a question about, like, you were laying down, so isn't that sort of that would naturally...
That still frame pretty much says it all.
Yeah.
That's like...
I feel like I would have the opposite effect. Like, my heart rate would double because I'm trapped in this sleep egg forever.
Yeah.
Sleep pods, not for claustrophobia.
I was like, is there a sensor that detects abject terror? Because that's what I was... it just seems like an overkill. Like, literally, just find a dark place and lay down, man. I don't know.
I want to... If it was a sensory deprivation pod, I would be into that, where it's like just totally closes you off from the sounds of the show. I thought that would have been really cool.
I like it because it reminds me of the chairs from Men in Black, which I've always wanted.
Spin around,
yes.
Egg chairs.
Yeah, exactly.
What was another thing that we saw? You know, Iaz, we stopped by there, but Iaz actually got to wear the suit, I believe, yesterday. We got to see the Applied Minds exoskeleton. It simulates aging. So it's really weird.
Ooh.
It's also right here in South Hall by interestingly enough, like I think it's upstairs way in the back. It's an exoskeleton that you wear in a suit. So here's the Genworth aging suit. This is Iaz wearing it. And as you're walking, it can actually limit and restrict your mobility so that you feel older. And it's got a bunch of biometrics.
Isn't that what you
want, Dan? Yeah,
seriously. Trackers in there. Well, so the idea, okay, wait, so we should explain what the goal of this is, because it seems a little weird. Like, I'm going to buy a suit that ages me to 100 years old.
The goal is to make you feel entropy as it's happening.
To help me cosplay as my grandparents.
Yeah, cosplay as your grandparents. Exactly right. That's your Comic-Con costume.
Exactly.
Grandpa.
Worst grandpa.
But the idea is Genworth wants to take this on the road in a tour to universities and different, you know, labs, things like that, and they want to teach people empathy. Yeah. For the elderly, so that when they care for them, they can sort of get a better understanding of what, you know, an
at
older person
it,
might be experiencing.
At the end of the experience, a large speaker just shouts, "Call your grandma!"
Yeah, exactly. It's like that really...
Put on a sweater.
Anything else you've seen that's cool. Weird?
One thing that I saw, I might be butchering the name, Sensodyne. It's an alarm clock that it releases scents to wake you up. So you can get like cocoa or peppermint to gradually ease you into the morning, which I find offensive on a personal level because I do not have a sense of smell, so I'm going to be late for all of my appointments.
Wait,
when are they going to solve that tech problem?
Do you not have a sense of smell legitimately?
No.
You have no sense of smell?
No. Where's my handicapped parking sticker? I had to walk all the way across the parking lot to get here. It's unfair.
Can I just say...
Are all of your other senses more heightened?
I can jump 10 feet vertically.
It's like Daredevil but with your nose.
Yeah, like Daredevil but 1,000 times worse.
It's smell devil or something.
Yeah, I have to say, you're actually pretty lucky because you can't smell the people in the show.
Oh, I thought you were going to say because you're sitting so close to Jeff right now.
Oh, yeah, that too. Yeah, I smell terrible.
I'm sure you have a delightful musk.
I'm really shocked by this. So this is
Lexi with
this
it.
Is the
sensor
wave. Thank
there you.
You
go. Lexi was checking this out earlier in the week. There's so much weird stuff over at Tech West. Everybody in the audience, if you haven't made your way over to Tech West, highly recommended. There's 3D printing and robots and just the most random stuff you could ever imagine. But keep in mind that a few years ago, GoPro was just the founder with a tiny little camera just asking people, like, will you please check out my action camera? And now they have a booth.
Bathroom stall.
10 times that size. Yeah, exactly. It's like just those little tiny stalls. And now it's this huge thing. Last year, I think they had BMX riders and stuff. So
you never
know what's going to be big in a couple years at CES that you saw. Maybe it'll be a really big deal.
Definitely worth taking a stroll through there to see some of the cooler, weirder, smaller things.
Yeah.
I was checking out one booth and I turned around because I heard a little voice. It was this tiny vacuum robot that started following me and talking to me. I thought it was a bit at first, but then it was asking me more and more questions. It was too much pressure for me, so I walked away.
Wow.
What do you believe its mission was?
I don't know what its mission was, but I think it's up to no good. Definitely working with the First Order.
Do not trust vacuum robots at this show, you guys.
I think that
they're
if he had
everywhere.
Had a sense of smell, he would have noticed and that it was there earlier.
I know, because I would have smelled fear.
Okay, we'll ask you this. What is the one thing... Tech-wise, it doesn't have to be a specific product, but what's the one thing you've seen at the show where you're like, that is 100% pointless?
100%?
Not for you. Like, obviously, an alarm clock with smell, is that's totally pointless for you, but for everybody. What's the thing that's like, that's ridiculous? 100%
pointless. I saw it was a robot that just cleans your grill. That's it. Like, you can do that with a spatula. No, not Paul Wall style.
Oh.
Like, your barbecue grill.
Ah.
Just like, that was the first one that came to mind. It just seems... Like, you don't need to have a smart grill. Just believe in yourself. You're already pretty smart.
You can do it.
Just take your spatula, take the little brush, just 5 minutes after you're done.
You know,
that's it.
Yeah, but have you considered...
A robot arm that helps me clean the grill. Like, I don't get tired. Like, but then I'm just going to atrophy and waste away.
Yeah, exactly.
And then I'll be just like that exosuit where it simulates aging. I'll be 100 years old.
It'll be like in WALL-E. We're all just rolling around in those space chairs.
Listen, I will do whatever it takes
grills.
To get my cupcake in a cup.
Clean grills.
That is my goal in life. Okay, so tell us a little bit about what you do over at Nerdist. For those of you who are not familiar with Dan Casey's work, Dan works for Nerdist. He does a lot of, you're not really a tech guy so much as you are movies, TV, like geek pop culture.
I cover a little bit of everything.
Yeah.
I'm a jack of all trades, master of none. I cover TV, comics, music, science. We have special people, people who are more specialized, like Kai Hull covers science, Matt Grossinger covers music, Blake Forte covers games. I get to do a little bit of everything, which is awesome because I get to see the whole broad spectrum of nerddom. I'm the senior editor over there, so I cover a little bit of everything. We try to keep it positive. I host a weekly pop culture deep dive called The Dan Cave. I've written a couple books. You can check those out online. So yeah, it's fun. I just get to nerd out, talk about things I'm passionate about with people who are passionate about those same things.
What do you think is going to be the biggest trend out of the show this year?
The biggest trend out of the show this year, I think, is probably going to be, I'm torn between drone technology, like everyone and their mother has a drone to show off, And I think autonomous vehicles. I think that is something we're going to see more and more of, especially the Detroit Auto Show right around the corner. And I think that's something that they're really going to be pushing for going forward.
Are you ready to be in an autonomous vehicle? Do you trust it, or are you a skeptic?
No, I think about every time is that scene in Total Recall in the Johnny Cabs when things go awry. I am not ready to let a robot take over the wheel.
All you have to do is pull the head off,
exactly,
and take control yourself.
They're poorly manufactured.
I love it. Okay, so how can we find you online? We're going to wrap the show up, and then we got to go check out, as you mentioned, my mom is showing off a drone here. I'm just joking.
Ooh.
She totally is not. But yeah, we're going to go check out some of the show. So tell everybody where they can find you and Nerdist online. It's pretty easy for Nerdist.
Yeah, exactly. You can find all the stuff I write about at Nerdist.com. You can find me on the World Wide Web at Osteoferocious. Dan Casey was taken.
Fair enough. I always wondered about that.
We're
going to
have
a...
After we wrap here, we're going to have a very long conversation about what life has been like without the sense of smell.
Yeah.
I am intrigued.
That is a dinner conversation. I wish I would have known that 3 days ago when we all had dinner together. Okay, so that is it for our CES coverage at Tomorrow Daily.
It's been awesome.
It's been amazing. Thank you for sharing the field of battle with me this week,
Jeff. Oh, thank you, my dear.
Delightful.
You've been the best.
We are going to be back on the CNET live stage. Not us specifically, but CNET will be back for CES coverage at 2 o'clock with cracking open a hoverboard.
Yeah.
Get out your fire extinguishers, everybody.
Oh, I hope that doesn't happen.
Things could get dangerous here. I'm just saying. But that is it for Tomorrow Daily.
Yes.
If you want to find us online, we are at Tomorrow Daily on Twitter and all over the internet. You want to share the show with a friend, please do, tomorrowdaily.com. And, of course, you can always email us with your feedback tomorrow@cnet.com.
We'll be back next week with regular shows every single day.
Yeah. So thank you so much for watching our coverage here at CES 2016. We will see you next week. But until then,
be good humans.
Be good humans. Bye, guys.